Don't find a way to fight back. I'm saying, if Farrakhan wants to do this stuff, if Farrakhan wants to start this race war and talk about how death is preferable, to living the way we're living and all that stuff, well, he should be the first one to bust a grape in the food fight. I mean, you have the Nation of Islam behind you, which is thousands of black people, thousands of black men, and you're talking about what we should be doing? You're living out in Hyde Park. Didn't he live like around the corner from Barack Obama? And you're talking about what black people should be doing and what you expect and 10,000 soldiers? Farrakhan, you've been around how long? You haven't done anything. You haven't done anything to kind of challenge white supremacy.
Hashtag justice or else. If this is not a call for terrorist attacks in our country by Louis Farrakhan toward whites, I don't know what else is. And if Louis Farrakhan was a white man calling for folks to kill black people, he will already be in jail. It would be national news. Loretta Lynch would have already held 20 press conferences talking about the number of people she's going to send out there to investigate this.
So far-reaching.
Tim, I have to say, I don't see a difference between denouncing and rejecting. There's no formal offer of help from Minister Farrakhan that would involve me rejecting it. But if the word reject, Senator Clinton feels is stronger than the word denounce, then I'm happy to concede the point. And I would reject and denounce.
Good.
Okay.
Excellent.
And terrorism. This Black Lives Matter movement is not a political movement, as the DNC just found out. This is a mob militant movement, and it needs to be stopped and stopped now before we start seeing a lot of blood of officers in the street and the blood of these young men who are being talked into doing this bidding for George Soros and Louis Farrakhan.
I'm going to pray for you.
Wow. So what do you say to Farrakhan?
So Farrakhan calling him a devil and all of that. You know, he should have just said, you know, that's not what you needed to have said, and given a better example and taken the high road rather than fanning the flames. It just fans the flames.
All right, let's talk about fanning.
Like Jadena said, that have to deal with that emptiness when they go into the room with that voice that they don't hear anymore. We want you to know that we come here as human beings deeply, deeply, deeply saddened and moved to help do something. So as artists and musicians, in addition to being human beings, we decided to create a song called Hell You Talk About. We want this song to be used as a tool in all communities around the world. We're about unity, unification, and we're about being on one side to end having to say any more names, no more names.
Right.
So as we call out the names of those we've lost, this is yours. As you go to your rallies and you go home, you do what you choose. We have the transgender community here as well.
Right. Right.
We have women. We are people. Right. We are all one.
Right.
Who are you talking about?
Hell you talking about? Hell you talking about? One of the primary organizers of the Million Man March was the late Dr. Dorothy Height. This march was so heavily supported by black women. Now, this year, the 20th anniversary, the commemoration, is open not only to black men and to black women, but to all of the disaffected who suffer from injustice right here in the continental United States, such as the Native Americans, the Latino population, our veterans who go to war and come back and have to fight for housing and medical care and jobs, women who work at the same status and level as men and don't get paid as much.
And this morning you plan to begin the process of celebrating the 20th anniversary by holding meetings to kind of get people on board.
That's right. And we will be meeting at the King Center this morning at 10 a.m. at 45 Beale Street. The doors open at 9 o'clock. I will be there along with Minister Farrakhan's local representative, Student Minister Anthony Muhammad, and that will be our official kickoff. Now, I do want to invite the people to visit Justice or Else, our website, also NOI.org. You can see clips of Minister Louis Farrakhan, who has been on a national tour. He has been meeting particularly with the youth and with the rappers and the so-called gang leaders to implore our people that in addition to the fact that we're being slaughtered in the streets of America at the hands of racists, at the hands of police, but most of our homicides are at the hands of each other. And we need to do something to bring together the black family, which means restoration of love.
Who have lost their children. And I will not let that happen without me using my voice. Now, on April 13th of this year, the Justice League took off from New York City, Staten Island, walking to Washington, D.C., protesting against police violence. What we found was that there was a Mike Brown in every town. There was an Eric Garner in every corner. And we found that our people are oppressed and depressed. What we are saying is that you can't pay us off. You can't give us lip service. You can't tell us about new training because you can't train a racist. The only thing you can do is fire a racist and ensure that the rest of the racists know we are not going to have it here in this city and across this nation.
Yeah.
So what we want is accountability. There are those who are telling us that firing one officer means nothing. It means a whole lot that a man that put his hands around the neck of another man in our community and illegally choked him to death, that he be fired from the NYPD if they protect and serve us. So we want Daniel Pantaleo fired, and all of his brothers and his sisters and all the other racists in the department, we want them fired too. Accountability is what we're calling for. You can't pay racism out of the department and out of all of the classist and sexist areas of American culture. And that's what they would rather do. So every time we leave, and I'm going, but every time we leave a Justice League gathering, we bring the sister Asada Shakur's voice into a meeting. So I want to leave you with this. It is our duty to fight.
Black people, be ye united, now and always.
10-10-15,
justice or else.
Justice or else.
Justice or else.
Justice or else. This is Zaza Ali.
My name is Dwayne Milton, and I'm the CEO of Brothers by Nature.
I'm Kwame Rose.
This is your brother, Martin F. Muhammad.
We are definitely going to be looking for our people to be in the building October 10, 2015 in Washington, D.C.
Before I come here as an organizer, I come as the mother of a 16-year-old son. And I know that you all know the stories of how the lioness will fight the lion over their child. So I come here thanking Reverend Wilson
first of all, for calling me into this space, but also for our brother, our leader, the Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan. Who is not only giving us an opportunity or giving me this opportunity, but also giving me a space to fight for my child. Because justice for him means more to me than anything else in this world. As he sits at home right now, I am afraid that when he goes outside today, he could be killed and no one will do anything about it. And so the courage that my generation has shown as they've been in the streets all over from Ferguson to New York City and everywhere across this country, I understand that that courage will not stand as strong as it should if we do not have those who come before us to give us what we need to keep pressing on. So everything that I have done in my life, all the work and all the service has brought me to a place where I am able to serve in this moment, justice or else, alongside my brother, Reverend Jamal Bryant. I want to thank you again, Minister Farrakhan, because I understand that my generation was waiting for a moment when we could all come together so that they...
Though it was billed as a press conference, it was anything but. It was a rally for Nation of Islam Minister Louis Farrakhan and against many of the recent events from Ferguson to Charleston that have angered African Americans.
We came to tell every racist, white supremacist, we don't die, we multiply. We gotta get justice or else.
That was the repeated theme, justice or else.
Because it's black lives that are being slaughtered.
We know what justice is. It's fair dealing. It's the law that distinguishes between right and wrong.
Farrakhan and others who organized the Million Man March in October 1995 will hold a 20th anniversary march in October to include people of all races, genders, and orientations.
They see the lack of fairness in this nation, and they are determined to make a change, and the way that we do that is with unity.
Farrakhan belittled efforts after Charleston, like calling for the removal of the Confederate flag.
Pull a flag down and you supposed to go away satisfied?
See, you don't know what justice looks like.
Justice Department to demand that Loretta Lynch will in fact take over the investigation of Sandra Bland. And because of your compassion for sisters and the affliction that's taking place, what is at stake for our sisters in this hour?
I think, first of all, I was crying when I called you, and I'm happy to be walking with you in this because our brothers are equally important. We must do it together. And for me, I am Sandra Bland. I could have been driving on that road. My mother could have been out there, my sister, and anyone else. And Sandra Bland was just someone driving down a street who should not have been targeted and certainly should not have ended up dead. And I heard my brother Freddie Haynes say, it doesn't matter what you think about how she died. The fact that she was in jail at all is where the blood is on the hands of the sheriff department inside of Waller, Texas. And it has happened again and again. And we know that since Sandra Bland, there have been five other women to die in the hands of police custody. That's an issue. When our women start to be attacked, we have to look at the vulnerability of that. What does it mean? They've already been killing our brothers. And now they're killing the sisters. So I understand that we can't sit by and watch this happen. And when 10-10-15 coming up, Sandra Bland and the women become the basis, the honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan talks all the time about the nation not being able to rise any higher than its women. And for that, we understand that that must be the anchor of what we do for 10-10-15.
Tell me, as we're moving closer to October, what is your vision of the role that sisters are going to play in this hour?
Well, first of all, sisters are leading movements all over this country. We know Black Lives Matter, Carmen Perez leading the Justice League NYC. There are sisters everywhere across this country leading. So I know we're going to turn out in mass numbers. It is our time to come forward and talk about the abuse that we have been suffering for many years that has gone unnoticed. Right. We've stood behind the brothers. We've been abused. We've been beaten. But we've also been the backbone. And it is our time now. now for the brothers to stand and lift our names.
Absolutely. The Justice League has really been emerging, and it's a reflection of this new paradigm of leadership that's taking place. We're now 1 year since the killing of Michael Brown. And we're having to recalibrate to say, where are we a year later? Both you and I came up through the ranks, you and National Action Network, me and the NAACP, and crossed each other growing through that, our own bro mitzvah, as it were, trying to cut our teeth. What is it for the millennials? When in reality, Tamika, this generation has not seen victory. When they were 15, they saw Trayvon Martin get killed and nobody go to jail. When they turned 16, they see Michael Brown and nobody go to jail. They watched on television Eric Gardner get killed and nobody go to jail. They turned the channel and watched Freddie Gray and nobody go to jail. So what do we say to this generation who's not seen victory? And we see hear people say, oh, be patient, it's going to get better. What do we speak to this hour and to this generation?
And, you know, speaking of that generation, I have a 16-year-old son who I am also cultivating to be a part of the movement. But we're not just seeing people being killed by police. We're seeing people in our communities being killed by one another.
Yes.
And so the millennials have a responsibility, particularly as we become the young professionals that think because we drive Mercedes-Benz and we've moved out of the neighborhood, it's not our issue. Well, tell Sandra Bland about that as she was on her way to her new job.
Wow.
We as millennials have a responsibility to be at the forefront of this movement, because the people that you've named have been the ages of folks who are on the ground right now, not people who are necessarily older than us. Folks who are older than us have done the work already. It's our opportunity to step up to the plate and not just tweet about it, not just talk about it, but actually take it to the street and handle it.
What is the responsibility that some of the most influential people now, embarrassingly, are not the clergy, but are entertainers? What is the responsibility of the rappers and the athletes who have the ear, the eyes, and the attention of this generation? Do they have the luxury of saying, that's not my fight, or that may cost me a sponsorship?
Well, they certainly don't. And I believe that the relationship between Minister Farrakhan and Reverend Willie Wilson out of D.C. is what we need at this moment, to come together with the church and the mosque in every community and turn out. I grew up in a church. But every Sunday, my parents would make a decision of whether or not we were going to Mosque Number 7 in Harlem or if we were going to the church, because we are under one. That brother that just said that, did the great song, that's what it's all about. It's one. One church, one house, one love, and it's one fight, because we're all dying. They're not checking to find out whether or not you're a pastor when they're stopping you on the street.
Absolutely. As we move forward, how can people start to organize in their local church? Colleges are getting ready to reconvene in the next couple of weeks. How can they get involved? How can we start to mobilize? They're watching us on television, on the internet, and are fired up, ready to go. How can we become a part of what you're talking
about?
We
need people to go to justiceorelse.com, justiceorelse.com, where you can get all the information that you need to sign up and to organize from your local city and bring your issue to the forefront. As you said, 20 years ago, it was men that convened in Washington. Today, Minister Farrakhan is calling on all people who have been oppressed, all people who are feeling the oppression in this country. And if you care about the oppressed, you can join us in Washington, D.C. on 10-10-15.
Good afternoon, my beautiful kings and queens. It is Wednesday, April 8th, 2015. Hopefully you are out there or were out there this morning doing something productive, successful, something that is going to help establish your kingdom and queendom. Today's Sandy Speaks is going to focus directly on my white people. White people. Yes, black people know that all lives matter. But what I need you guys to understand is that being a black person in America is very, very hard. Although you all love to say, oh, nobody should see race, people are the reason that racism is still alive. Well, what kind of people are the reason? Black racists have no power, whereas white racists do. They have power because they are in positions of control, or they are in positions where they can influence the control over black people. Yes, that is very true. So to my friends who want to get on my videos and they're upset about the picture that I posted, oh well, I will not apologize for it, because at the moment, Black lives matter. They matter. Our media is showing you, obviously they don't. So for y'all that can sit around and say all lives matter, I want you to go put it on a poster and stand out on a corner somewhere. If we can get enough white people to show that all lives matter, maybe they'll stop killing our Black brothers. Because obviously that's what it's going to take for the white people to get up and get tired of Black people saying Black lives matter. So if y'all want it to stop, you get out there and do something about it. But what you're not going to do is get on my page with the foolishness. You will be deleted. You will be unfriended. I am not a racist. I grew up in Villa Park, Illinois, was the only Black girl on an all-white cheerleading squad, so I had to learn how to deal with, and Black people, you will not be successful in this world until you learn how to work with white people. But I want the white folks to really understand out there, Black people are truly, we're doing as much as we can. Not all of us, but some of us are really doing as much as we can. And we can't help but get pissed off when we see situations where it's clear the Black life didn't matter. For those of you questioning why was he running away, well, goddamn. Because in the news that we've seen as of late, you could stand there, surrender to the cops, and still be killed. So for those of you that feel like all lives matter, if you want to put it on the poster, I will stand out there with you. But if you're not ready to do that, do not get on my page with it. Plain and simple. Plain and simple. You might have a Black friend or two. And I'm not calling all white people racist, because y'all not. But for the ones who want to get on my page talking about all lives matter, show me in American history where all lives have mattered. Show me where there has been liberty and justice for all, like that fucking Pledge of Allegiance we love to say. Excuse my French, because Sandy speaks don't usually cuss. But I was really irritated by the responses to the post that I made earlier, because white people, if all lives mattered, would there need to be a hashtag for Black Lives Mattering? Good morning, my beautiful kings and queens. It is Friday, April 10th, 2015. It's kind of chilly out here this morning, so hopefully you bundled up. Kings and queens, someone proposed me with the question the other day, and I'm a little stuck on it. I was asked, was I trying to racially unite or racially incite? Well, honestly, I feel that my goal is to racially unite. Now, in the process of doing that, some people will be incited, i.e. upset, because based on the history of America, it is not good when it comes to Black and white people. But I want us to try and get past that. And that is ultimately impossible. It's impossible to happen until certain people realize they were born into a certain type of privilege. And it does not matter if you never break a law, if you never get into any trouble. Part of the reason for that being is the police don't even suspect you of doing anything wrong. And that's just how it is. For those of you who did not like the video that I posted earlier this week or yesterday and decided to get on my page calling me a racist, a dumb bee, I just think quite disrespectful. You know, guys, you don't have to watch my videos. You really don't. Because at the moment, they're not for everybody. I would want them to be, but unfortunately they can't be, especially when we're talking about a subject as touchy as race, race relations, all of this mess that's going on in America. So for those of you who think that I'm a racist, please remove yourself from my page and just don't watch Sandy Speaks. Sandy Speaks does not promote racism. Sandy Speaks does not promote going out there and killing all white people.
I don't know if you, those of you who feel that I'm a racist, didn't see a couple weeks ago me walking around a Fox Valley Mall holding a sign that I spent my money on, took time out to make, that said, all white people are not against us. Because I don't truly feel that way. But for those of you who cannot accept and acknowledge the white privilege that you were born into, no fault of your own, but just accept it and know that, yes, black people are going to be mad when we see things like our brothers being gunned down, murdered. And for those of you who can say, oh, well, why was he running? Why was he breaking the law? Let's just flip the script. And if that was your uncle and he ran, do you think he would have got shot 8 times in the back? Probably not. They might have got him in the leg. I am not a racist. I'm going to share a little bit of y'all, of something with y'all. For so long, I was so misguided and confused. I thought that the only way to have pretty kids would be to marry a white person. Yes. Ooh. My mind was so messed up. But I see clearer now. There are kings and queens in all of us. But at the moment, the people who truly need to be realizing their kingdom and queendom are my black brothers and sisters. I'm sorry.
Kill us. Are you all going to be peaceful? Well, should we be? That's a question we got to keep asking ourselves. Everybody that stands up for us, they say, is this going to be a peaceful demonstration? Mm-hmm. How can peace be there if there's no justice there and the government is weak to stand up for us, and we pay the taxes of these people that shoot us down? We pay the taxes for an education that does not educate us properly, that we can come out of school and do something for ourselves? We gotta go back and beg them for what we could unite and do for ourselves? We've got some serious decisions to make.
Now, when you say that, I understand and I feel you.
But part of my problem is I feel like they don't look at us until the riots happen. But I see so many of us, young black individuals, getting arrested, getting those F's on our records. And then later on in life, it's almost like because we stand up, they give us nothing after, and we can't have anything after because we have a felony on our record. We can't get a job. We can't help raise our children. We can't do a lot of those things. So what can we do?
We have to decide, do you still want to live under that?
No.
Or do we want to confront the government and say, like Moses said to Pharaoh, let my people go. Mm. Damn it, if we can't get justice, if we can't have peace, if our children are dying in the streets and there's no redress for our grievances, why the hell should we stay here and continue to live like this and then join an army and go somewhere and fight for the same damn enemy that's doing what he's doing to us? We got to make a decision, and there's not much time left to play with life and to play with the future of our children and all these weak leaders that are apologists for tyranny. They have to get out of the way because our children are angry. I would not mislead them in their anger to do something to get them killed or slaughtered. But there is a verse in the Quran that says persecution is worse than is us. But the war that we gotta fight is on two fronts. We can't go to Washington and tell the government, step up, you stop killing us. And Mayor Giuliani comes up and says 75% of the people that die in the hood are black people killing black people? He's not lying. So we've got to go in our community and straighten that out. They are not guilty in our community. This is what you call social engineering. Mm. The enemy planned this and did it. And pardon me, you know, I'm very passionate.
Oh, talk, brother. Talk, talk.
As you
talk,
can see. Because I don't have no time to waste. I'm an old man. And I don't foot around with the truth because we don't have time for diplomatic language. Mm-hmm. We got to say it like it is and then back it up with our lives if necessary. Right. I'm 82. I don't know how much time I got, but I want to leave this world with our people in a better state. But sometimes it's going to take the sacrifice of life to produce a better tomorrow. And sisters, this peaceful coexistence with the murder of our people has to stop. It is all right for us to march against injustice, but the time may soon come, or maybe has come, for us to retaliate for injustice.
Yes, sir.
Wait, wait, wait. If the Justice Department doesn't do its job, the Justice Department is supposed to see that those of us who are afflicted get equal justice under their laws. We are dying in every city. In every state, in every town. And what is the Justice Department doing? Why don't you step up to the plate, Justice Department, and fight for the rights of those whose rights are being trampled upon by the force and power of the army of police, FBI, ATF, sheriffs, and whatnot. What are you trying to force us to do? It is written in the Holy Quran. Let me quote to you what God said.
God said.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
O you who believe. Retaliation is required, is prescribed for you in the matter of the slain. The free for the free, the slave for the slave, the female for the female. But if remission is made to one by his aggrieved brother, prosecution for blood money should be according to usage and payment to him in a good manner. This is an alleviation from your Lord and a mercy, but whoever exceeds the limits after this will have a painful chastisement. Now, if it's a prescription,
yes.
Then if the Justice Department doesn't rein in these police that are killing us like this, if the local authorities don't see that injustice is stopped, you killed an old black woman here in Atlanta. And you said she shot at you. You killed her. But where's the penalty? You're killing our people every day. And your own brothers call it justifiable. It may be justified in your eyes, but we got eyes too. What are you trying to force us to do?
Force us.
Well, you say, Farrakhan, now, Farrakhan, I asked the Justice Department, do you want us to go to that point?
Yes, my Lord.
Even if that would be committing suicide, it would be better to commit suicide than to continue to live under the very shadow of death from your evil hand.
That's right, Brother Minister. That's right, Brother Minister. That's
right. Do you want me,
yes,
as the voice of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad, and really a voice of God,
yes,
to ask our people to retaliate in matters of the slain, a life for a life? Is that what you're driving us to?